Video? Not in there? It's okay if it is. It's alright. You know what John 14:1 says? Let not your heart be troubled. Exactly. All right. Hey, good morning, y'all. How y'all doing? Let's try again. Good morning, y'all. There we go. How y'all doing? This is the day the Lord has made. So we're so happy to be glad in it that we're going to stand up and sing along, aren't we? Y'all ready? Well, we'll start again. Here we go.
By and by, I'll secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
No fiddle.
To walk in the pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Sing with me, leaning. If you feel like you need to sit, you can. We've got another song to go here. But if you want to stand and stay standing, that'd be fantastic. Our next song is one that I think just speaks to the very glory and splendor of our God. So.
Darkness tries to hide. great.
He's great. Awesome. Y'all may be seated. Good morning, Ignite.
Good morning.
How are you? It's good to see you all this morning. My name is Gray Handwerk. I'm the coordinator of guest and new member ministries here at Mount Tabor, and it is my joy and privilege and blessing to be with you in worship this morning. On behalf of myself and Jim Annis, our worship leader, and Bob Richardson, our assistant pastor and lead pastor of this worship service, we welcome you into the presence of God this morning. We will worship him and lift his name high, and I'm excited to do it because how great is our God. Yay. So if you're a guest this morning, I can't help but I get excited. I love Jesus. I know. If you are a guest with us this morning, your presence is a gift to us. We believe that God has brought you to this place because he wants to be with you this morning, and we want to be with you too. And we're excited to get to know you. So if this is your first time, we have a gift that we'd like to give back to you. If you'll come out to our welcome desk after the service, we would love a chance to get to know you, to meet you, to shake your hand, and give you that gift. So please don't rob us of that blessing. Come and visit us at the welcome desk. And now it's a great time for everybody who's in fourth grade or younger to follow Miss Colleen to kids' worship this morning. She's over here by our back door all the way on the left-hand side. Anybody who is 4 years old to fourth grade, you are welcome to go. They're going to worship the Lord just like we are, just in a kid-friendly way, I guess. They're going to do a lot of fun singing and dancing around, and they're going to do a lot of things to lift high the name of Jesus. If you are in fourth grade or younger and you don't want to go to kids' worship, that's okay, too. We'd love to have you here. We have a lot of fun in here, and you can sing and dance in here, too. And we have a great area in the back called our playground that you're welcome to make use of. We've got a children's bulletin back there that you can follow along with, and you're welcome to use that at any time during the service. We do come together in community. And I think one of the big reasons that I love to come to church is just how this community reminds me of where my focus needs to be. And reminds me what God is doing, what God has done. And I love it this time when we come together as believers, looking to the one who wants to be with us, wants to help us, wants to be involved in our lives. And some of us may be fighting some battles this morning. Sam and I were listening this morning to this is how I fight my battles, and I'm surrounded by you. You know, you may be in the fire this morning. You may be in the darkness this morning. You may be in the wilderness this morning. But we come together to encourage one another and to lift one another up. And we can carry one another to the cross. We can carry one another to the feet of Jesus, knowing that Jesus is the one, God is the one, through his Holy Spirit, who will provide for us. And an encouraging word for us this morning is from the book of Exodus, chapter 14, verse 14, when Moses is leading the people out of Egypt. And this is all they've ever known. And it's scary. And they don't know what's going to happen. And there is a very powerful Pharaoh chasing after them with a mighty army. And this is what Moses says to the people: don't be afraid. Stand firm and see the Lord's salvation that he will accomplish for you today. He says, the Lord will fight for you. And you must be quiet. Some versions say, and you must stay calm. Well, that's easy, right? But hear what he's saying. The Lord will fight for you. And the Lord held back the waters. He fought. The Lord is in your battle with you. The Lord is in your darkness with you. He's in your fire. He's in your wilderness. And the way to stay calm, you're doing part of it here, is just being in his presence, resting in his presence, looking to him. You know, in that fiery furnace with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, there was someone else there. God is there in your fire with you. And part of that staying calm is looking for him. And so I just encourage us this morning to look for him. And sometimes we find him in the eyes of those sitting around us. And sometimes we find him in the stories that other people share of how God was in the fire with them, how God held back the waters for them, how God went to a cross for them. And so that's what we do here together this morning. We pray for one another. We welcome your prayer requests. We cherish them. and we pray over them every week faithfully on Tuesdays at 1:30. We pray over each one by name, and we take them to the one who is in the fire with us, who is holding back the waters, who is making a way where it seems there is no way. So we invite your prayer requests. You can bring them to our prayer wall in the back here of the worship center. You're welcome to use that at any time. You can write it on the connection clipboard as it goes by. You can write it in your bulletin and tear it off and stick it in the offering plate. You can go online. You have a hard time this week. Come Wednesday, it's too much. Go online and let us know your prayer requests. We would love that. You can talk to any of us, and you can talk to each other. We can pray for each other. So let's do that. We're gonna, we have taken all your prayer requests from last week. They sit in our prayer cross, which I don't know where it is. No, it's supposed to be right there. I put it there. I don't know where, it's on the prayer table. Okay, it's on the, whew, okay, because I put it there. No, it's on the prayer table. All of your prayer requests have been prayed over. God is working. We're going to pray together, and I'm going to invite you. I'm going to leave a time of silence where everyone in this room, your voice is important. Your voice is important to God. He wants to hear from you. So lift the name of someone on your heart. Give a word of thanks, whatever it is. Let's go to him and let's pray together. It is a privilege. Gracious God. Gracious God. We thank you for your word. We thank you for your promise. We thank you that you promise to be with us no matter what we are going through. We thank you that you have shown us through the example of your word that you are with us and that you do not leave, that you make a way, that you walk alongside us even in the difficult times. And God, we just praise your name for that, how great you are. That you are mightier than any fire, that you are bigger than any wilderness, that you are able to stop any storm, God. You are powerful and you are mighty and you are awesome and you are great. And God, I just thank you that in your might, that you are mighty to save us. That in your might and in your power and in your awesomeness, you care about each of us. You care about each of us in this room and what we're going through. And I just praise you for that, God. I lift your name high, God, that you care for each of us. And so, God, we call on your power and your might and your awesomeness and your greatness, God. We call on you. We call on you, God, because we need you. And God, I pray that you would open our eyes to see you. Open us up to know your presence, to know that you are here. And God, I just pray that you would come near and hear these, the prayers of your people who love you.
I lift up to you the name of Scott
and of Amy.
God, I thank you.
I thank you that you hear us. I thank you that in your word it says that you heard the cries of your people and that you were faithful to be with them and to lead them in the right way. And so, God, we just claim that for ourselves, God, that you would hear our cries. And God, we know that you are faithful to provide. And so, Lord, I just pray that you would remind us of your faithfulness, that you would open our eyes and ears to recognize what you are doing, because you are doing everything for the good of those who love you. So, God, we thank you for that. We praise you. And now, God, just turn our eyes to you, that in this time of worship, we would see only you. We would think only of you. We would lift your name high and sing your praise and thank you for how awesome and how great you are. We give this worship to you, God. We pray that it is pleasing in your sight. May the words of our mouths and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you, God. We pray all these things in the mighty and precious name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. We do continue our worship through our tithes and offering. Our ushers will be coming forward with the baskets. There is a special offering this morning. You'll see that in your bulletin. There's an envelope there for the prison ministry. We encourage your participation in that offering. And as was mentioned, the UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, is doing great work already to help those who are suffering. You can always write UMCOR on a check if that's something that you would like your money to go to. So please return a word of thanks to the Lord for what he has given you, and give of a glad heart, and he will accept our blessings, and pray that he would use our gifts to spread his name in this world. We are also going to continue our worship through passing our connection pads. If you are on the ends of your rows, I encourage you to please, or even if you're not on the ends, if you have to get up maybe and walk down or hand one to the rows behind you. This is a great way for us not only to know that you are here, but for us to know that each other is here. So please pay attention to the names on that pad as it goes by. Pay attention to who's sitting in your row. Talk to them after the service. Pray for them during this week. This is a connection for all of us. As I've been saying, we are all in this together. Let's do this together. So let that be an important part of our worship. And we also continue to worship through song. We thank God for our musicians who bring us this music. We take in what they are singing and we give it to God. Let it be for his glory, not for our own. May this be a word that lifts high the name of Jesus.
There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the name of Jesus. Break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Break every chain. Sufficient sacrifice, so freely given.
Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, this morning and all of history is about you. Please guide Pastor Bob to help us worship you with undistracted heart. You know how our minds wander the upcoming week, thoughts of family, work, school, and other things. Help us put those thoughts away and focus on you and your glory. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Ed. Good morning. How are you? My name is Pastor Bob. I get to be one of the pastors here at Mount Tabor United Methodist Church. Thanks, as always, for the blessing of worshiping our Lord alongside you. It means everything. Picture on the left is Dr. Sidney Friedman, a recurring character. Have I got that? Yep. On the old TV show MASH. He's a fellow played by Alan Arbus. Dr. Friedman was a psychiatrist who was frequently summoned to the 4077th Mobile Army Surgical Hospital, aka MASH, to treat patients with mental health issues that were beyond the scope of the so-called meatball surgery that was being performed in the operating room by unit doctors like Hawkeye Pearson, B.J. Honeycutt, among others. The fellow on the right is the Reverend Francis John Patrick Mulcahy, a.k.a. Father Mulcahy, another recurring character on the show, played by a fella named William Christopher. Father Mulcahy was the eunuch chaplain who was frequently summoned to the bedside of patients who were dealing with more spiritual matters that were beyond the scope of the aforementioned meatball surgery. An episode from the series' sixth season finds Friedman nearly at wit's end after a particularly harrowing session of the aforementioned meatball surgery, where for a time he has actually been forced to put down his psychiatrist sign and pick up scalpel and suture and operate, after which he makes his way to Mulcahy in the hopes of debriefing from the horror. In his tumult, he tells the good father, when Pierce or Honeycutt lose a patient, he's out of his misery. But when I lose a patient, I've lost a mind. Father Mulcahy ponders for a moment and then tells the good psychiatrist, when I lose a patient, I've lost a soul. Dallas Willard was an American philosopher and author who wrote of the Christian spiritual formation and once said, what matters most, what marks your existence, the really deep reason why human life matters so much is because of this tiny, fragile, vulnerable, precious thing about you called your soul. You are not just a self, you are a soul. You are a soul made by God, made for God, made to need God, made to run to God, which means that you are not meant to be self-sufficient. We are in week one of a four-week series of sermons designed to align with our church-wide study of John Ortberg's book called Soul Keeping, Caring for the Most Important Part of You. This week, I get to focus on the first two chapters of the book titled The Soul Nobody Knows, and What is the Soul, respectively. But from an introductory perspective, Ortberg writes about that oft-used but oft-misunderstood part of every human being called the soul, which the author refers to as the hinge on which everything else in our lives hangs, whose health or lack thereof will determine a life of deep spirituality or an existence of restlessness and dispassionate faith. Ortberg cites a study of hundreds of church members who believe in the existence of the soul but were hard-pressed to define just what it is. Not unlike former Supreme Court Justice Potter Stewart, who once said of obscenity, "I can't define it, but I know it when I see it." A scientist of a century ago tried to define the soul by getting the weight of the soul, measuring the weight loss of 7 tuberculosis victims at the moment of death, which led him to claim that the soul tips in at 21 grams. What is not difficult to define about the soul is our tendency to neglect it. Instead of focusing on this eternal part of ourselves, we cast our sights on the temporal concerns of the world. The consequences of this apathy are materialism and consumerism, the misguided notion that we can buy our way to happiness and status and wealth. Ortberg writes that we speak of the soul as a source of strength, and yet we speak of it as fragile. Something about the soul always seems at risk. The soul is something that can be lost or sold. Though don't try to do that on eBay, which a cash-strapped woman actually tried to do, a woman named Lori, only to find that they have a no-soul-selling policy on eBay, which lets them avoid taking a stand on whether or not the soul exists in the first place, a stand that strikes me as soulless. As an aside, and not to stir anything up, yeah, right. This guy, Derek Jeter, has often been described as the soul of the New York Yankees. Well, Derek Jeter retired 5 years ago. Does that mean that the New York Yankees have no soul? As a Red Sox fan, I'm okay with that assertion. Not to stir anything up. Yankees won last night, though, right? I have got to admit to that. But we won Friday night, just saying. To define what is the soul, Ortberg, as he will do throughout this volume, relies on the wisdom of his mentor and teacher, Dallas Willard, whom I quoted earlier. Willard uses an illustration of 4 concentric circles to show what is, as Ortberg writes, the life center of human beings. There is the will, which Willard calls very central, but also incredibly limited. Want proof? Friends, in 1980, I trained for, ran in, and finished the Boston Marathon. It took me about 3 days, but I did it. Now, I got willpower. However, put Krispy Kreme donuts anywhere near my radar, and it is on like Donkey Kong. I'm a living, breathing example of what the Apostle Paul said in his letter to the church at Rome, verse 15 of chapter 7. I don't really understand myself, for I want to do what is right, but I don't do it. Instead, I do what I hate. Can I get an amen? We're all in this together, Gray. The next circle is the mind, but it too can be subject to the slings and arrows of culture and context. I am fully capable of thinking things that are less than, shall we say, noble. To return to the writings of Paul, again from Romans, verse 6 of chapter 8, so letting your sinful nature control your mind leads to death, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life. While my mind may crave to be at peace, too often my thoughts allow it to be at war. Our bodies make up Willard's third cycle, which are delicate and intricate and yet incredibly powerful. But they too are not the whole story of who we are. This is a picture of Bill Moser, a member of the family of faith here at Mount Tabor for better than 40 years. Bill was vibrant and active. Every day I had the blessing of crossing his path, but then was diagnosed with amyotrophic lateral sclerosis, or ALS, a degenerative disease that affects the nerve cells of the brain and of the spine, a disease that took his body and then took his life. Bill passed away in the middle of last month, but while ALS claimed Bill's body and claimed Bill's life, it could not claim Willard's fourth circle, the soul that was as abundant in Bill as life itself was. In calling the soul the operating system of life, Ortberg again quotes Willard by writing, "The soul is the capacity to integrate all the parts into a single whole life. The soul seeks to connect us with other people, with creation, and with God himself. And when you are connected to God and other people, you have a healthy soul." Bill may have physically succumbed to a devastating disease, but his soul was as healthy as the day is long. In Scripture, soul is synonymous with the person. It is who we are. Of the roughly 75 times we read of the soul in the New Living Translation of the Bible, better than a dozen of those citations come from Jesus. Never more notably than in the book of Matthew, the 26th verse of the 16th chapter. After having demands for miracles placed on him, after hearing his disciples bicker once more about the literal bread when he's trying to teach them about spiritual bread, after finally getting Peter to see just who he is, Jesus, the Messiah, after predicting his own death on the cross and insisting that his disciples be willing to take up crosses of their own, to lose their lives, to fully gain their lives, Jesus says these words, "And what do you benefit if you gain the whole world but lose your own soul? Is anything worth more than your soul? Is anything worth more than your soul?" is what Jesus asks of his disciples and of us. And inherent in the question is the answer. No, no, 1,000 times no. The soul is integrated. The soul is connected. The soul is in harmony. The soul lies at the center of it all. But as I've prayed more about just what Jesus was getting at in his assertion about the soul as worth more than anything else, I think he was also declaring it foundational. The definition of foundational is relating to or forming or serving as the base of a foundation. Cool. So I suppose it would help to get a clear notion of just what is the foundation. And Merriam-Webster describes it as the underlying base or support. It is that on which everything else is built, on which everything else rests. It's a troubled time. One need not be prophetic to be keenly aware of the tumult of today. How can we combat that as a community? I don't mean to rain on the go time parade, but I would like us to consider one issue of the thousands by which we are confronted as a culture. I've shared before that our daughter Lulu and I have a book club. And as Gray once sweetly sang, they have a book club. You can't come. Sorry. But we get together once a week and discuss the book we are reading together. We read together. This is a picture of a new friend of mine named Chris Cox, who in my eyes is just heroic in her willingness and passion to confront one of the foundational woes that ails us all today. Chris is the executive director of ReadWS. The vision of ReadWS is a transformed community in which every child learns to read, write, and spell. Forsyth County, like the nation, is in a literacy crisis. 48% of children in Forsyth County are not reading proficiently. A student struggling with reading in the third grade has a 74% chance of still struggling in the ninth grade. 42% of children in Forsyth County enter kindergarten at risk of needing additional support with reading. There are established links between what is known as the school-to-prison pipeline, where students from marginalized communities have a greater tendency to find themselves incarcerated. And it all stems from an inability to read. Imagine all that does not happen without the ability to read. This sermon doesn't happen. Perish the thought. I joke, obviously, a little. But Reed Winston-Salem is addressing the foundational malady of the inability to read. And in doing so, they are getting to the heart and soul of the matter. The gift of literacy, once given, can never be taken away, lost, stolen, or outgrown. It is the gift that will eternally and divinely keep giving. Thanks for allowing me that little foray into soapbox territory. I'd like to close this morning by quoting Ortberg's story of Horatio Spafford, who invested most of what he had in real estate. He lived in Chicago and lost everything in the Great Fire of 1871. It destroyed his home. He had no insurance. He lost most of his money. In 1873, he put his wife and their four daughters, their son had died earlier of scarlet fever in 1870. He put them on a ship heading to England as he stayed behind to re-stimulate his business. A few days after the ship departed, he received a telegram from his wife. "Saved alone. What shall I do?" There had been a shipwreck. All four of their daughters perished. Horatio quickly boarded another ship to England, and as it passed over the very same place in the ocean where his daughters had drowned, he wrote these words to a song. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. Are we foundationally firm today? Is it well with our soul today? Are we embracing the assurance that we are souls made by God, made for God, made to need God, made to run to God? Are we connected to the world, or are we connected to God? Whatever our lot, is it well with our soul? What are we going to do about it? Let's pray. Gracious God, thank you so much for the witness of your works, for the witness of your words. Thank you, Father, for the reminder that it is well with our souls when we are connected to you and not connected to the world. Help us recognize that we are made for you, that we need you, that we run to you, and when we do, it is well with our souls. We pray all of this in your precious and mighty name. Amen.
Will you stand and sing with us?
Lord, my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand hath made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder. displayed when I think of God His Son, not sparing, sent Him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, He bled and died to take.
Mission at Mount Tabor to gather joyfully, to grow spiritually, and to go faithfully.
So, gather, grow, and go. This morning we've gathered, right? We have hopefully grown as a result of the scripture and the sermon. And so now that brings us to the third in the trifecta, the go. It's go time.
This is an opportunity for us each week to give you some items that you can use to go this week and do things in ministry. So the first thing that we have this morning is we're starting a church-wide study on September 8th. We are, as a church, going to be reading a book together called Soul Keeping by John Ortberg. The sermons will follow that book for the next 4 weeks, and we will have small groups, Bible studies, Sunday schools. We'll all be talking about the same thing. If you'd like to be part of that, there is information about that in your bulletin.
That leads us to the next super coolest thing that we have for Go Time. And we're going to bring this back up to you several more times. But on October the 19th, right here at Mount Tabor, right here, we have one of the best contemporary Christian worship bands that I believe I've ever experienced. And the name of the band is Iron Bell Music.
You are the God that saves. You are the one that rescues me. It's your rescue.
We need you to go online to the Mount Tabor website and get your tickets. Tickets are $15 for general admission, $25 for a VIP treatment. We hope everybody can come October 19th to see Iron Bell.
Don't call the church office. Go to the website.
All the tickets are on the website. So yes. I guess that's it for this week.
I think it is. You know what?
It's go time. It's our mission at Mount Tabor to gather joyfully,
stop it,
to grow
stop, it's my turn,
and to go.
Thank you. Susan and I were reading the second part of this the sermon series, these chapters 3 through 5 of Mr. Ortberg's book. And the most frequent word you heard as we read it together was, dang, dang, this book hurts. This book explores, and this book gets to the heart and the soul of the matter. It's not easy, but it's essential. And so I would urge you all, if you can, if you're able, to get a copy of the book and study along with your church as your church considers our soul. But Jim often likes to pray when we pray just before the worship service. It's not about the numbers. It's not about how many people are here. There's one person today, or one person whom you will encounter this week, whose soul is troubled and needs to connect with you. And in doing so, when they connect with you, they will connect with God. And then it will be well with their soul and with yours too. Go in peace.
Hall.